and we need to hit it strong. We need to not, you know, worry about ourselves so much and how our future is going to be negatively affected by us speaking out, because all these taboo subjects can really, you know, cause us a problem. I mean, it's obvious. Nobody, you know, nobody's unaware of that. Everybody can feel the pressure. I think Ray was talking about how we can... What's that?
You know, first of all, what is your relationship with this committee that you're talking about, or this movement that you're talking about? What's your relationship?
Which movement is that? Which movement is that, Ray?
What's that?
Which movement are you talking about?
The Democratic movement that you mentioned.
Oh, you're talking about the National Initiative for Democracy? Well, you know,
yes,
I didn't know about it until my wife found out about it in the 2008 election. She was going for Mike Gravel, which is a former senator of Alaska who is proposing this, and she was voting for him, and I was interested in Ralph Nader just because, you know, he's the odd guy out. He's always been a person that has fought for consumer rights and, you know, the rights of the people. You know, he's a graduate from Harvard, and instead of working for a big bank, he went and fought for the, you know, rights of the people. And so, based on that alone, I was voting for Ralph Nader, and she was going for Mike Gravel. And when we started supporting the National Initiative for Democracy together, shortly after that, about 6 months later, Ralph Nader jumped on the bandwagon as well. And so they're both kind of backing this National Initiative for Democracy. For me, it's not that I'm affiliated in any way, shape, or form. I actually have never spoke to either one of the guys or any of their organizers, but I've been advertising it on my website ever since I found out about it. I think it's absolutely awesome, and that's all it is to me.
Okay, that's good. You've got a website. What is that?
That's www.xcannabis.com. And that's the letter X, CANNABIS.com.
Okay. Ryan,
and
tell us
your
little bit
there on the
about
top there, Clayton. Just to let you know, we're advertising for
you.
Yeah,
Clayton, you're on there.
Okay, great, great. And this show will be, you can download this show as an MP3 by going to Blog Talk, hit the player on Blog Talk and save to your default player. It'll save it as an MP3 file for you. And
cool. Hey, I do appreciate you, Clayton. I just want you to know, I appreciate the airtime, and I have a lot to say. It's not monetarily or politically motivated. You know, I don't have any sponsors or any backers. I'm just a concerned citizen that served 8 months in jail in Utah for simple possession of marijuana when I was a kid. And I'll tell you what it did to me. You know, this is what broke my heart and made my life absolutely difficult for 10 years, is I went to jail for 8 months. At 19 years old, I had no skills, I had no training, I had nothing, and I served 8 months and got out and had a drug charge, which, you know, disqualifies me for all kinds of different benefits, including serving in the military, which my family is a very historically military family. My dad was a 101st Airborne Green Beret, my grandpa flew in World War II, and I planned on getting military experience and going to college with the GI Bill, and I got denied when I applied for military service because of my drug charges. I had three of them, and they said they could nullify the one, they could expunge the one if I only had one, but I had three, and all three of them had possession of marijuana, possession of paraphernalia, each different arrest, and they were always for just simple possession. They weren't for dealing or cultivation or manufacturing or intent or any of that. It was simple possession of marijuana, and so that essentially,
I helped start the paraphernalia industry. I helped start the head shops. I sold the head shops in every state in the union. I helped them go. My first salesman went to and started graphics, and I helped. I financed Jack Hara while he was going through that. I helped start Normal. I was the first distributor for High Times in Texas. I've been fighting this battle for 40 years.
Awesome.
And we have made some progress here. You know, we've got governors. My friend Governor Gary Johnson of New Mexico has gotten involved in the legalization, has spoken out for the legalization. We had it on the ballot in California. So we have made progress, and we do need people like you. But let's not forget about us old folks over here. I need donations.
Absolutely not. You know, and that inspires me to know that people are out there from the generation that started this in the 60s. And quite honestly, we wouldn't be anywhere without you guys. I mean, that's how I feel. And there's, you know, nothing but love. We, you know, as far as my my personal feeling about you know, moving forward is we need everybody. And without everybody, we're not going to get anything passed. But without your guys' fire and without the catalyst you guys brought to the table in the 60s, we wouldn't be doing this. So, Clayton, don't have any, you know, suspicion that I don't respect you or the movement that happened back then, because that's absolutely, you know, what started this, and I believe that.
Never suspected that at all, Ryan. You're on
awesome,
my show. I trust Ray. You know, he's doing the work. I trust Roger. You know, Roger and my son. And Ray, you've met my son too, haven't you?
Yes, and Trevor is in Colorado, which is a state, you know, like Reverend Ryan is in Washington. Reverend Ryan, let's get back to your blog and talking about Roger there. And then the normal little thing we had at Normal. Talk about that to the audience and how I met you on the blogging at Normal.
Well, sure, yeah. You know, I've fought with this issue on Normal, on the stash, for the last 8 months when it started getting brought up. Radical Russ Belleville mentioned it before he got arrested and was talking about the Church of Lighter Wallets was the name of the post. And I took absolute, you know, reservation there to say my piece, and I told him everything that was on my mind, which I believe, you know, he's talking about how these sanctuary kits are being sold, which they're not. They're being given for donation, but they're not being sold. And I explained to him that, you know, I've taken Roger Christie's information off of his website and went to the Universal Life Church at UAL.net and got my ordination without paying Roger a dime. You know, it's not that Roger requires payment. It's that people donate as a gift, just like I do to Normal. I donated $70 when I started.
There you go.
Normal.
Now you're talking. Oh, baby. Now you're talking the truth.
This is the thing that, you know, that we're seeing is the division. We're divided again here, you know, in the cannabis community, and that's why, you know, I've been trying to reserve myself, just like you have, and not say offensive things and not attack people, but to actually state what the truth is. And so when I responded to Russ, I said, hey, you know, Russ, I donated to Normal myself, and, you know, I got a T-shirt for it, but I donated extra and above because I wanted to see Normal succeed. And I've donated ever since. I've donated, you know, hundreds of dollars multiple different times over the last 2 years when I first got started with Normal. And I said, I do that not to, you know, make you guys rich and not to see you guys be fat cats. I see you guys making progress, so I donate. And people see Roger Christie, you know, making progress and dedicated to the cause and being there for people and relieving people's spirits of trouble, you know, that they've been burdened with.
Fine.
And I feel strongly. Go ahead.
Ryan, this, I wouldn't even bring this up, but it's happened too many times. And we're talking this week about other people that are in jail too, as well as Roger. Roger came on my show. He helped. He allowed me to become involved, and they went to jail. He went to jail with no bond, and I believe this show is monitored. And when people start making an impact, and there's nothing, I mean, everything that you've said here, everything that he said is absolute fact, is truth. And the government will go after you. It's not Hawaii coming after him, it's the feds that came after him, isn't it?
Right, it is.
They don't want the truth out. They don't want this information out. They don't want me. They don't want Edgar Steele. They don't want Roger Christie talking to the people because we make too much sense. This this is the largest cash crop in America, and it was stolen from you in 1939. That's the same as going in and taking your gold, stealing your children, kidnapping them, and enslaving them. You've been enslaved, ladies and gentlemen. That's what the free
Absolutely.
America has been talking.
I agree, Clayton. I agree. And this not only this prison industrial complex that I talk about is enslaving us and putting us in prison, and more than any other country in the world are we being put in prison for victimless crimes.
They're selling
but
on
we
the
also
stock
see
market.
Things
these
like these. I'm sorry, go ahead.
These prisons are on the stock market. The banksters are promoting these private prisons. It's an expansion
Absolutely.
Industry, and they plan more and more of you in. And every time we pass a law, the medical marijuana law, we take money away from these prison systems. They're getting they're charging the state $50,000 to house you because you had a joint in your pocket. Right. Well, something wrong with that.
There is. And it's all profit for them. I mean, they're not looking at it from a federal government budgeting perspective. They're looking at it from a lobbyist and corporate and greedy perspective of, hey, I don't care how much, you know, it's just like with this war in Iraq.